Hello, everybody. My name is Mihalis Yannakakis. We'll talk today about the computational complexity of the Hylland-Zeckhauser scheme for one-sided matching markets. This is joint work with Vijay, Vazirani. One-sided matching market, we have N agents and N individual goods, and we are given the preferences of the agents for the goods. We want to find an allocation of goods to agents, one good to each agent, that makes the agents as happy as possible given the situation. Hylland and Zeckhauser proposed a scheme in 1979 which uses a pricing mechanism to find a good allocation of goods to agents. The allocation of Hylland-Zeckhauser scheme, HZ scheme from now on, has several desirable properties. One is that it produces Pareto optimal allocations. That is, you cannot, there is no allocation that is better than HZ allocation for all the agents. In other words, if one allocation is better for one agent, it's going to be worse for some other agent. Second property is that it's incentive compatible in the large, which means that agents have no reason to misreport their preferences, as long as the market is large enough. Now, more specifically, in a basic scheme, as I said, we have the setting for one-sided market, N agents, N goods. And for each agent and I and each good J, we have the utility, we're given the utility UIJ. So this is numerical value that signifies how much agent I likes good J. The goal is to find an allocation of goods, one good to each agent. So the goods are indivisible in the final allocation, but for the purpose of the scheme, we regard them at first as being divisible. That is, we regard this good as being one unit of probability that can be shared among the different agents. So each agent is going to be allocated a total of one unit of probability shares from possibly from different goods. So the full allocation of the scheme is going to be a fractional perfect matching between agents and goods. So if you think of a bipartite graph between agents and goods, it's going to be a fractional perfect matching. Each agent has a total of one unit of share distributed among different goods. Each good provides one unit of probability share, possibly distributed among different agents. Of course, our original goal is to get integral matchings between agents and goods. But we know from matching theory that a fractional perfect matching is really a convex combination of integral perfect matchings. So using atomization, you can pick one integral perfect matching in this convex combination with the corresponding probability. And the result will be that you produce a randomized integral perfect matching with the property that the expected utility of every agent is the same as the utility in the fractional perfect matching that the scheme produces. So the heart of the HZ scheme is to find a good fractional perfect matching between agents and goods. To do this, it sets up a market and looks for good prices in that market. So the market is like a linear Fisher market, what's going on as a linear Fisher market, a type of market that has been studied for a long time, is understood very well, has very good algorithms. But now there is a little wrinkle that we have the perfect matching requirement. So the setup is that in the market, we have a supply, we have a set of divisible goods, and the supply of one unit of each of the goods, so divisible goods in this setting. We have a set of agents that come to the market with their utilities, so UIJ for each good. And every agent has a budget of $1. Now, if the prices are set for the goods, then every agent will look at the prices of the goods and will pick an optimal bundle with, subject to the dollar that the agent has, that maximizes her utility. So every agent picks an optimal bundle. And now we want to set the prices so that the market will clear. In other words, for every good, the supply will be equal to the demand. The amount that the agents get is exactly one unit. This is the setting for the standard linear Fisher market. The only wrinkle here is that we want also to have a perfect matching on the agent side. So we want every agent to get exactly one unit in total of goods. So there is the extra condition that every agent has to get exactly one unit. So analytically, here we are looking for an equilibrium set of prices and allocations, so a vector of prices for the goods, an allocation vector X of goods to agents, with the following three properties. One, the allocation is a fractional perfect matching. That is, for every good, the total shares of the good is one. For every agent, the total shares for that agent is one unit. Second, every agent spends at most $1, so the cost of the agent's allocation is at most one. Third condition is that every agent picks an optimal allocation, an allocation that maximizes the utility subject to the constraints. And there are two constraints. The total size is one, the cost is at most one, and of course, no negativity. There's a side condition that if there are many optimal allocations, we want the agent to pick one that has minimum cost. This is kind of an extra condition that is actually important for Pareto optimality. But these are the precise conditions for the equilibrium. Now, first question is, do you always have such prices and allocations? And the answer is yes, and what was proved by Hylland-Zeckhauser in the 79, the existence theorem, there is always at least one set of equilibrium prices and allocations. And the proof was via Caputani's fixed point theorem. It's a non-trivial proof. They have to work a little bit to make to make sure that the conditions of Caputani's theorem are satisfied. But of course, one big thing about fixed point theorems is that they are, and Caputani's especially, is that they are non-constructive. So they don't provide an algorithm. So the open question is, how do we compute such an equilibrium? That has remained open since then. The only thing we know about the computation is that if you fix the number of agents or goods, then you can do it in polynomial time, but the polynomial has the number of agents or goods in the exponent. So in general, of course, it's an exponential algorithm. So we would like to know whether it's such an algorithm, polynomial time algorithm, is possible in the general case. As a result, we have not resolved ultimate question, but we have made some good progress in understanding the problem. First, we here give a combinatorial, strongly polynomial algorithm for a special case, the case where every agent has two valued utilities. In other words, the utilities for the agent assume only two values. Some of the goods have high value, and the rest of the goods have a low value. Second result is that unlike the case of the linear Fisher market, which is very nice, everywhere has all kinds of nice properties, equilibria are always rational if the input utilities are rational. This is not the case in our case. Adding this extra matching condition can destroy many of the nice properties of linear Fisher markets. In particular, there are examples where there are only rational equilibria. So that means that we'll have to compute equilibrium in that case, up to some precision, of course. And it signifies that some of the nice properties of fisheries markets do not hold. Another property of fisheries markets, for example, does not hold. For them. So you have to notice that the gross substitute property does not hold here. That means that it's possible to raise the price of one good, and a consequence of that is that some other good has less demand. This usually signifies trouble for computation. So where does the problem belong to? Which complexity class? We saw that the problem is in the class fixed P. Computing an equilibrium, HZ equilibrium, is in the class fixed P. And we define a notion of approximate equilibrium, that is a vector of prices and allocations which do not satisfy exactly the conditions, are allowed a little room for violation. And we saw that such an approximate equilibrium problem is in PPAD. So in this talk, we will go very quickly. We will not have time to go into detail in the results, but we'll give a flavor for each of the results. So we start first with the two-valued case. So every agent has some goods that they like a lot, they have high value. And the rest of the goods they like less, they have a lower value. We represent this situation as a bipartite graph, which has the agents on one side, the goods on the other side. And for every agent, we connect it only to the goods that have high value for the agent, high utility for the agent. So in this example, agent one has high value for the first two goods. Now, so this ignores the precise numerical value of the utilities, but it's not very hard to see actually that the precise numerical value is not so important. It's the structure in this case. In the two-valued case, it's just the structure that is important. So the algorithm is rather simple. It's a combinatorial polynomial time algorithm. First thing we do is we look for a perfect matching in the graph H. If H has a perfect matching, then we use this matching for the allocation. We allocate every good to the agent to which it is matched and set all the prices to zero. This is a very likely situation. It's a very good situation. Every agent gets a good that he values highly. Couldn't expect anything better. So this is best possible for all agents. Second case is when there is no perfect matching. So the maximum matching has size strictly less than n. In this case, we find the minimum node cover. And matching theorem, from matching theorem, so minimum node cover, remember, is the minimum set of nodes that cover all the edges. Matching theory tells us that the minimum node cover in a bipartite graph is equal to the maximum matching, so it will be of size smaller, strictly smaller than n. So in the picture is the green nodes, let's say, are the minimum node cover. Some nodes on the agent side and some nodes on the good side. So we partition the graph into two parts, H2 and H1. H2 contains the agents in the minimum node cover, the green nodes, and the goods that are not in the node cover, the orange nodes. And H1 is the opposite. It's the goods in the node cover and the agents that are not in the node cover. So for H2, we just look separately at the two subgraphs. For H2, we find the maximum matching. Note that H2 will have fewer agents than goods. So like in the picture, there are fewer green nodes than orange nodes in H2. And the fact that the green nodes are a minimum node cover, it's easy to see that it implies that the maximum matching in H2 is going to match all the agents. So we use this matching for the allocation of the agents. So every agent gets a good that they value highly. So all the agents are very happy in A2. And we set all the G2 prices to zero. Note that there are more goods in G2 than there are agents in A2. So that means that some goods in G2 are not matched, have not been allocated. Now for H1, we view it as a linear fishing market. So we ignore the size constraint of the agents. We just keep the budget constraint and solve it as a fisher market. We run the DPSV algorithm, the Vanur, Papadimitrios, Saberi, Vazirani algorithm for linear fisher markets. But in fact, this is a special case. So it's a very simple form of that algorithm is sufficient to get the optimal the equilibrium prices and allocations for the market on H1. When we do this, so the algorithm is very simple, but unfortunately we will not have time to go into precisely in details so in the talk. You can look it up in the paper, how it gets simplified in this case. The algorithm is going to set prices for the goods in G1. All the prices will be one or higher. And we'll allocate them fractionally now to the agents in A1 in such a way that all the budgets of the agents in A1 will be exhausted. So the agents in A1 will spend all their budgets on G1. They may not get enough size because, as you see in the picture, the size of G1, the green dots in the lower graph, is smaller than the size of A1. So A1 will not satisfy the size yet, will spend their whole budget, but not the size. And then as a very last step, we allocate the unmatched goods in G2 to the unsaturated A1 agents. So as a result, all the agents get exactly one unit of goods. And it's easy to see, and the proof is in the paper, that all the agents are happy. They get their optimal, an optimal bundle given the prices. So this is the algorithm for the two-valued cage. It's a simple combinatorial polynomial time algorithm. Prices are all rational and easily computed. Now the general case are more difficult. First of all, in terms of the existence, the only proof we had was that the one via Kakutani's, a fixed point theorem. And problems that need fixed points usually belong to two kinds of classes. PPAD and fixed P are the two natural homes for these problems based on fixed points. PPAD is a natural fit for problems whose equations, fixed point equations, are linear or piecewise linear. And one characteristic of problems in PPAD is that there is always a rational solution, and finding it is the problem of computing such a solution is in NP. In fact, in TFNP, the total search problems in NP. Typical examples of complete problems for PPAD is the Nash equilibria for two-player games or market equilibria for some classes of markets, for example, for separable piecewise linear concave utilities. Fixed P is a natural home for problems where the equations are nonlinear, nonlinear algebraic equations. And as a result, they represent the contained problems where the solutions may be inherently irrational. The problems are generally harder, and fixed P is contained in P space, and probably it's close to P space. So these are one level up in difficulty. Typical examples of complete problems for fixed P is Nash equilibria for three-player games, and market equilibria for some other kinds of markets. For example, for non-separable piecewise linear utilities, in particular for Leontief utilities, complete for fixed beam. So the first question we have to ask for our problem is it linear or non-linear? Are the solutions rational or irrational? And the answer is actually they are irrational. There are examples where the HZ equilibria are irrational, in fact, small examples. There is 4x4 examples, 4 agents, 4 goods, as the example shown in this picture. So this shows the agent's utilities, you know, small, simple numbers. Where there is a unique equilibrium, and an equilibrium with unique prices and unique allocation. And the prices are as shown in the slide. P1 has price zero. It's always the case, in fact, that for every in the HZ setting, you can always give to one good price zero. In fact, the minimum valued good, the good with minimum price, you can always set it to be zero. That's a normalization that you can always do. So in this case, price one has the minimum, good one has the minimum price zero. The other three goods have irrational prices. And all the allocations are also irrational, except for the zero allocations. All the non-zero allocations are irrational. They contain this square root of 17 somewhere. And this is not a pathological example. Actually, you can take this pattern of this 4x4 example, and you can change all the non-zeros pretty much any way you like, as long as you keep the preferences. And essentially, no matter how you put them, you're going to get an irrational, unique irrational equilibrium in this case. By the way, this is the smallest example in that you can show that 3x3 examples are rational, inherently rational. But from 4 and up, we get irrational examples, and that's actually, we expect that in most cases, it's going to be irrational. So this suggests that the right class, the right home for this problem is fixed beam. And indeed, we show that the problem belongs to fixed beam, at least as an upper bound. This is the class where it belongs. Now, the original Kakutani proof does not seem to render itself for proving the membership in fixed beam. And for this purpose, we give a new proof of the existence of an equilibrium using Brouwer's fixed point theorem. And to remind you, the Brouwer's fixed point theorem says that every continuous function f from a convex compact domain to itself has a fixed point. So in our case here, we pick a domain for the prices to be between 0 and n. That's a large enough safe domain where guarantees we get the equilibrium prices. And the domain for the allocations, we require the condition that every agent gets one unit of goods. And of course, all the allocations have to be non-negative. We define the function f to play place the problem in fixed beam. We have to define the Brouwer function to be a polynomial time, either a circuit or a straight line program. We use a straight line program that uses the standard algebraic operations, addition, multiplication, and so forth, and max and min operation. So for fixed beam, you need to show the, represent the function either by formula, a circuit, or a straight line program. A program gives us more flexibility to actually write an actual, we write a pseudocode for this program because the function is not simple. Note that the program cannot use branching, no if then else, because if you do that, then you lose continuity. So it has to use just the continuous operators, algebraic operators, max and min, which are continuous, and then automatically you get that the function is continuous. The function f is defined in such a way such that the only fixed points of the function are the equilibrium. So what the function does is that it looks at any input, it takes a price vector and an allocation vector. It looks at the vector and sees if it satisfies the equilibrium conditions. And if it does not, then it adjusts the prices and the allocations, try to improve the feasibility of the inputs of the vectors, if they are not feasible, or prove the optimality if it's not optimal. So remember that the equilibrium conditions, there is a set of conditions. One of these conditions is satisfied automatically by every input vector, namely that every agent buys one unit. That's part of the domain requirement for the allocation. But the rest of the conditions are not required, so an arbitrary input price and allocation vector is going to may violate some of them. So the function is defined in such a way that it adjusts the prices and the allocations to try to improve feasibility or optimality. And there is a number of cases, so the pseudocode contains several cases corresponding to the different conditions, and the theorem then shows that in fact, if the only fixed points will be the equilibrium that places the problem in fixed B. So this is for the actual exact equilibrium, if we want to compute an exact equilibrium, or if we want to compute approximately an exact equilibrium up to some precision, so up to some bits of precision. You can define a notion of approximate equilibria where the conditions are satisfied only approximately. And we defined in the following way. The first condition of having a perfect fractional matching we require to be satisfied exactly. And that this is important because we do want the market to clear. We want the goods to be totally allocated. And we want each agent to get exactly one unit, because then when we do the randomization, we want to get a true matching of goods to agents. What we allow violation is for the other two conditions. So we allow the cost to be 1 plus epsilon, and we allow the agent's utility to be suboptimal by an amount epsilon, a small amount epsilon. And also with the extra side condition, we allow the cost of the allocation to be off by epsilon from the minimum cost of an optimal allocation. So we allow a leeway for the cost and the optimality condition. And we show that such approximate equilibrium, actually the computation is in PPAD. The proof of this result is based on the same Brouwer function. This function has the property that it's polynomially computable. We said that already, and it's also polynomially continuous. So the modulus of continuity of the function is polynomial. And such functions have the property that computing an approximate fixed point is in PPAD. Approximate fixed point, not in the sense that it's close to a real fixed point, but rather that it moves a little bit by the function. So the function does not only perturbs it the point a little bit. So we show that the function, the Brouwer function we defined is polynomially computable and polynomially continuous. And to prove the membership in PPAD of the equilibrium problem, then all we have to show, the theorem is that if we compute a delta approximate fixed point of F, in other words, where the F shifts the point only by delta for some suitable delta, then this gives us an epsilon approximate equilibrium for the HZ scheme. And the delta, of course, that we need depends on the epsilon and depends also on the size of the input, on the number n of agents and goods and the number of bits in the utilities, but depends, well, depends polynomially, so we'll get the membership in PPID. So to summarize, we have shown membership of the problem, the equilibrium problem in PPID, and the approximate equilibrium problem in PPID, but we have not shown hardness. So the obvious open problems is the equilibrium problem fixed P-hard, and is the approximate equilibrium problem PPID-hard. We suspect they are, but this looks like look like difficult problems. So we leave it as open problems and hope that some of you will be able to resolve it. And so hard, or if it is actually there is a way to compute them in polynomial time, that would be fantastic. It remains to be seen. And as a third open problem, we showed that two-valued utilities, we can, there's a very simple combinatorial algorithm. What happens with three-valued utilities? First of all, rationality, is there a rational equilibrium? Of course, for four-valued and up, there is no, we know that it may have to be irrational because we gave a 4x4 example. But for three-valued, we do not know at present if there is a rational equilibrium, and we do not know of a polynomial time algorithm to compute either an exact or an approximate equilibrium. So these are the top problems to work on. And so this is all, and the more details can be found in the paper. And thank you very much.